Good evening. Welcome, and thank you to everyone for joining us. This is Stay at Home, a video education project that we're doing at Jacobin. Sorry, I'm not used to being live on the internet or having my face on camera. It's a video education project that we're doing at Jacobin during these months when we're all stuck at home and figuring out how to make sense of the world in order to change it. We have a guest almost every night, usually at 6 p.m. EST. And the format is that guest discusses an idea for about 25 minutes. And then from there, we do a Q&A with our live YouTube audience, which in this case is you, the people who are watching right now. So if you have a comment or question, drop it in the YouTube live chat and we will ask our guest about it. My name is Daniel Denver. I am the host of The Dig, which is a podcast from Jacobin. If you're not familiar with it, you can find it wherever you get podcasts. It's an unusual podcast in a few different ways. It's extremely long, in-depth, complex discussions about anything you might imagine. The most recent episode is actually a shorter one that is about an hour long with Micah Utrecht and Megan Day, also of Jacobin, on what happened with the Bernie campaign and where we might go from here. I'm also the author of a book that came out a few months ago called All American Nativism, How the Bipartisan War on Immigrants Explains Politics as We Know It. And I was on tour for that book before the whole world turned upside down. I was in New Orleans, supposed to be going to Texas, a lot of places in Texas, and then had to go back to where I am now in my home in Providence, Rhode Island. But hopefully I will be back on the road if those things start to happen once again one day. So we have a lot of exciting stuff coming up in the next few days for Stay at Home. Tomorrow at 6 p.m., we have Daniel Finn, who will provide a brief history of Irish republicanism and some context for Sinn Féin's recent electoral victory in Ireland, which is something I am very curious to know more about. On Saturday at 1 p.m., not 6 p.m., but 1 p.m., we have an installment of Weekends with Anna Kasparian and Michael Brooks, and they will be speaking with Brianna Joy Gray about the Sanders campaign and where the left goes from here. I always love hearing what Brianna has to say, as much as the haters love to hate on every single thing she says or tweets. Then at 6 p.m. on Saturday, we will have Katerina Principe, who will talk about the legacy of the Carnation Revolution, which ended the military dictatorship in Portugal and brought democracy to the country in the 1970s. Please subscribe to Jacobin's YouTube channel and share the videos. There's not enough of a left presence on YouTube, and we are trying to help remedy that. So please subscribe and share this video and other videos. Over the last few weeks, we've already developed a lot of content. Jacobin's also been putting the Digs audio on to the Jacobin feed, because I'm not a YouTube person, but I know many of you out there listen to podcasts on YouTube, even when there's no video. So for those of you people who do that, you can now do that on YouTube, which is great and something that I had been planning on doing, but not doing for a long time. All right, which brings us to tonight's speaker, who is Kate Aronoff, my good friend, and she will be talking about the coronavirus, the collapse in oil prices, and what that means for our prospects for achieving a Green New Deal. Kate is a staff writer at The New Republic and a co-author of A Planet to Win, Why We Need a Green New Deal. Her co-authors on that are Alyssa Battistoni, Daniel Donna Cohen, and Thea Rio Francos, who could walk through my front door any minute now. She's at CVS. Kate is also the co-editor of We Own the Future, the author of Overheated, How Capitalism Broke the Planet, and How We Fix It, which is forthcoming from Bold Type Books. She is also a co-host with Daniel Adana Cohen of a podcast called Hot and Bothered at Dissent, which you should definitely check out if you are interested in climate politics and eco-socialism and all of those things. All right, without further ado, Kate, take it away.
Thank you so much, Dan. Well, first off, thank you to Jacobin for putting this talk and this whole series together. I think it's a great way for folks to be able to spend their time in this weird world we're now living in. So I am going to talk mostly about oil, and I will preface this by saying I am a journalist first and foremost. I am not, the world's foremost expert on oil markets, but have spent a lot of time thinking about this. It's a part of A Planet to Win. It's also a part of the book that I'm working on now, and help sort of try to think through kind of the very strange moment we're in with regards to oil markets. And I think, the reason I wanted to talk about this in the kind of universe of all of the things we could talk about now, including a green recovery, including, the many different sort of implications that this moment has for the climate, is in part because as someone who's tracked the Green New Deal and tracked sort of climate policymaking conversations for the last little while, there is not that I've seen a lot of kind of fluency around sort of basic dynamics in oil. And I think in the last couple of days since the price crash on Monday, have been seeing kind of a bit of a lack of analysis around kind of what this all means. So I am going to attempt to provide, what I can only be a sort of layman's take on what this all means, and really how to think about what's happening at this time, as people who are interested, as I hope, many of us are on this call, in a Green New Deal and an equitable transition away from fossil fuels. So to start off, just I want to lay out kind of the basics of what's happened. So as people probably have seen, on Monday, for the first time ever, West Texas Intermediate, which is a type of light sweet crude oil, started trading for the first time at negative prices. So essentially what that means is that it cost more to store oil than to dig it up out of the ground. And why the price crash happened was because sort of contracts that were coming up for May were seeing that there was just a lack of space available. And so producers were having to pay actually for these storage facilities and kind of pipeline companies to take their product. Not all oil was trading at negative prices. So the international benchmark known as Brent was still, around $20 per barrel that day. And the sort of general reaction is within chaos. The Trump administration is now considering a bailout for the oil and gas industry, which has been talked about for some time. What's not clear is that they're actually smart enough to know how to take on the situation. But it didn't come out of nowhere, right? So there are a couple different factors that led into this. So the main, the main one I think that has been rightfully talked about is that demand for oil has really shut off as sort of economies are shutting down amidst the coronavirus and stay-at-home orders. People are not driving to work. They're not, going on vacations, taking planes, all of this. And so there's this big demand shock that's happening. There's also has been a price war between Saudi Arabia and Russia that Trump sort of pretended to have made a deal about, which, was worth basically nothing by Monday. But there were other factors leading into this, which were sort of longstanding and which, there had already been sort of a crisis coming in the oil industry before this. But we this really sped it up in a way. But just to talk through kind of what was happening before. So by the end of 2019, 42 exploration and production companies had gone bankrupt. And that was, you know, about the total sort of value of the bankruptcies was double what had been the bankruptcies the year before. So they were also facing $24 billion worth of bonds maturing by 20, basically a bunch of debt that was coming due that they had basically no ability to pay off. Most of these companies have never made a profit. They benefited essentially from, you know, very cheap credit created in response to the last recession. And because they had not made a profit, they were losing access to creditors on Wall Street, which had been very generous with them before this point. So, you know, this all kind of takes the sector that's most kind of implicated in this is shale drilling, which is a kind of unconventional drilling that happens in a couple different places in the United States. One of the, you know, most impacted is in West Texas, around the Permian Basin. There's also a lot of shale drilling in the Appalachian Mountains and a few other places. Kind of uniquely, the shale revolution, as it was known, operated in a way that oil drilling tends not to operate, which was as, you know, this sort of experiment as a free market. So rather than having you know, these kind of super major companies like Exxon or Chevron kind of dominating the field as, you know, had been the case sort of for a while before shale drilling took off in after the last crash. You had, you know, dozens and dozens of independent, so-called independent producers, so smaller companies who were essentially all competing against one another to produce as much as possible. And so the way that they got funding was to grow as fast as possible. And so there wasn't really any kind of overarching logic to it in the way that there usually is, which I'll explain in a bit, in most oil and gas production. So, you know, what I'd like to argue essentially is that the shale revolution, which is now kind of crashing down as a result of the most recent price dip, is an experiment with running energy as a free market that has failed. And I want to kind of, you know, talk a bit about how oil usually works, and then get into what options are, and essentially an argument for nationalizing at least very large chunks of the fossil fuel industry as a sort of equitable and redistributive response to this crisis. So I would say the energy system demands kind of a huge amount of government coordination. So the U.S. in that sense is kind of unique in the fact that it does not have a national oil company. Most oil around the world is sort of governed in these state-owned oil companies. People are probably familiar with companies like Saudi Aramco or Petrobras in Brazil or Pemex in Mexico. These aren't, you know, I don't think necessarily replicable models of what a, you know, just transition could look like, or what the sort of institutions we want to create as part of a Green New Deal, but are kind of responses to the fact that the complexity of oil, its sort of material reality, demands a level of higher order management that is very hard to do when the main goal is sort of short-term profits. And so having these kind of state-owned companies really insulates production from the very short-term demands that are put upon, you know, companies by shareholders to produce profits constantly. It's also why we see really high levels of internal strategic planning in companies like Exxon, Mobil, BP, or Shell. Steve Call has written in his book Private Empire. You know, Exxon in particular essentially operates like a small state. It has, you know, what look a lot like military bases in other countries. It has its own foreign policy. They really do, you know, are not like uniquely tied to a super short-term sense of profits, and really think quite far into the future. I have a dog at my feet, which might jump up at some point, so fair warning. So oil, you know, really does demand this kind of higher order planning that has not been present in shale. and a sort of level of state involvement that has to exist at the international level too. So for as long as there's been oil, there's always been a kind of cartel keeping it together. So people probably are familiar with things like OPEC. Before OPEC, there was the Seven Sisters, which was a sort of colonial arrangement based on rights to oil in the Middle East, mostly, and that was controlled in part by the Texas Railroad Commission, which kind of got its start in the 1930s. So the U.S. has approached this problem a different way. So, you know, there's been oil here for a while. It has not always been this kind of free market bonanza. And so the U.S. has this sort of patchwork of state involvement in extraction. A lot of drilling happens on state and federal land. Companies can get preferential leases from the government. There are roughly $26 billion worth, conservatively speaking, of state and federal subsidies in the form of tax breaks, both on the production and consumption side. And so, you know, all that's to say that the oil, you know, is not, and energy is not a free market. And really never has been. We've just approached that problem in different ways than countries with state-owned oil companies have. So I want to, you know, just to go back to the Texas Railroad Commission very briefly. You know, this is the Texas Railroad Commission has featured in the news more recently for wanting to kind of step in as to stop production in the United States in the way that OPEC does. Generally, they will impose these sort of supply cuts in order to drive up the price and kind of stabilize the markets. And so for the first time really, you know, in 40 years, the TRC, the sort of not totally accurately named body, which has nothing to do with railroads, has talked about, you know, entering into what are basically bilateral negotiations with OPEC to form a kind of OPEC plus plus arrangement that could provide the role that OPEC has historically of really regulating the international oil market and keeping prices at a level which is amenable to producers all over the world. And so one of the last times the TRC did this was in 1931. And in order to keep prices stable amidst deflation after the Great Depression, the TRC imposed supply constraints, and the governor of Texas sent in the National Guard and actually physically sort of kept people from drilling, producers from drilling up oil. So, you know, I think where we are now with the oil industry facing its biggest crisis sort of ever is that some kind of state intervention is inevitable, right? In expansion of the state intervention that already exists in oil. And so we've seen the Trump administration even considering supply cuts, which, you know, I think for folks who are familiar with the Trump administration, might seem a bit surprising. Something I've argued for recently, which we argue for in A Planet to Win, is that the left should have, you know, its own kind of response to this moment and be proposing a kind of state intervention into the fossil fuel industry, which sort of protects workers, looks to, you know, make sure that it's not just CEOs who are getting kind of bailed out in this situation, and ultimately to wind down production at the levels we know are necessary to deal with the climate crisis. So just to you know, give some sort of basic context for nationalization, which I think can sound almost like this really big sort of maximalist demand, is just to say that, you know, insofar as state involvement in oil is very matter of course, both in the US and around the world, nationalization also has sort of a rich history in the United States and particularly for sort of navigating out of moments of crises. So during World War II, about a quarter of all manufacturing in the United States was nationalized. More recently, the Bush administration nationalized airport security just after 9/11, and that created, you know, what we now know as TSA, displacing private producers kind of left and right. And even, you know, the sort of bailouts we're accustomed to seeing of things like General Motors after the last crash and, you know, any number of the bailouts now, are a kind of nationalization in which the U.S. government just gives up its power and equity stake to you know, have a say over how companies are run. So, you know, how would a nationalization of oil companies work? So very briefly, you can think about this as buying up currently very cheap stock in these companies, 51% of shares, and taking a sort of majority equity stake in them. I'll just say that, you know, these companies are trading at very low levels. The stock of Netflix recently surpassed that of ExxonMobil. So these are not, you know, necessarily huge numbers we're talking about. And these companies are really, you know, cheaper than they've ever been and cheaper than they will be probably for some time in the future when prices start to go back up as they probably will. I think here there's a real question of which companies to buy up, right? So as I mentioned, the shale sector is full of all of these sort of small, largely unprofitable companies. I think, you know, there is some thought that should go into which companies should be sort of allowed to go bankrupt. And, you know, is it better to focus on the kind of big firms versus, you know, these smaller firms? And kind of what is the role in all this of sort of supplemental universal assistance programs? So, you know, to what extent can we protect workers in some of these firms by, you know, having a big relief package, which you know, is more sort of, you know, universal versus, you know, buying up the fossil fuel industry writ large. But also, I think this is, you know, just a policy tool which has to be on the table. And is really a better alternative than a couple things which might, you know, happen without it. So one, of course, is a Trump administration bailout, which is, you know, just gives sort of no strings attached bunch of cash to the CEOs of fossil fuel companies, allowing them to basically sew themselves golden parachutes and screw over workers, just fire people, as we've seen in bankruptcies, you know, in the as you know, as is the case with other sorts of big corporate bailouts, in which, you know, a few years down the line, like happened with GM, CEOs can just fire, you know, as many people as they want, without, you know, any meaningful change to management structures or to production. Another alternative is that, you know, as these companies are really going bust, private equity sort of comes in and snaps up their assets and does the thing that private equity does, which is fire a bunch of people, get rid of pensions, get rid of benefits, all of that. And so in contrast to that, sort of the prime goal of any sort of nationalization should be to protect, you know, oil field workers, first and foremost, to make sure there are things like wage parity and pension protections, and also to ensure that, you know, the really much broader circle of people who are kind of adjacent to the oil sector are protected. So a lot of the tax bases of places where there is a lot of drilling depend on kind of high income jobs that are provided by them. Those, you know, the sort of spill out of massive bankruptcies in the oil sector could end up hurting things like public schools, local public health systems, and sort of any, you know, number of social services in already pretty cash-strapped cities and states. There are also importantly a lot of pensions that are bound up in fossil fuels. So the rise of passive investment sort of vehicles in products offered by companies like BlackRock and Vanguard, those also make a lot of sort of union members, a lot of retirees, sort of unwitting fossil fuel financiers. And so part of this would also be figuring out a way to make sure that folks who have, you know, fossil fuel investments by that are not, you know, necessarily the product of their choice are protected. And so there are a few proposals for this within about, you know, what protection might look like within the green stimulus. So it doesn't call for nationalization, but similar to Bernie Sanders' Green New Deal platform, calls for 5 years of wage parity for affected workers, along with housing assistance, job training, and early retirement options, a provision to replace tax revenue that might be lost as a result of bankruptcies, and provide ample funding for economic diversification. And just in the last couple of minutes, we'll talk about what sort of US, you know, if we are looking at something like a US national oil company, like those that exist elsewhere, and sort of the basic form of it, you know, what are the kinds of important things to consider about the design of that sort of thing? So first and foremost, I would say, is to make sure that the structure is democratic and has, you know, as a goal sort of written into its charter, a provision for the managed decline of oil production. And so to make sure that the company is operated kind of along the lines of the sort of, you know, hard limits on carbon that we know we have. Part of this could include sort of requisitioning their assets to store carbon captured from the air underground, and taking the profit motive out of the so-called negative emissions, which are controversial. Maybe we could talk more about that in the Q&A session, but I think are something that exists currently, is something that the private sector is very excited about. And if they are, you know, as important as I think some people argue, it's hard to imagine that should be operated as anything other than a public good and a public utility, and not subject to kind of profit making. So they could also, a kind of US energy company could also be sort of regionalized in the way that other national oil companies are. So, you know, not entirely a top-down structure, but where the sort of basic goals are set out, and then management can happen in kind of different parts of the country, you know, in some ways similar to something like a TVA or any number of kind of regional power authorities. There's some kind of model for that. This could also have a huge effect on renewable supply chains. So if we think about a US energy company as one which can, you know, both be winding down traditional oil production, but also be providing renewable types of fuel, so wind and solar, that could have a huge impact on the supply chains for renewable energy, which, you know, are controversial and sort of evolving. There's a lot of efforts to reform them, and sort of a US, you know, US energy company buying up massive amounts of those could really have a set some sort of standards about what those supply chains could look like, and just use sort of the raw purchasing power of the US government to do that. So I think the other, you know, the other thing that's important to mention about nationalization is that it can really, maybe most importantly, neutralize the massive political clout of the fossil fuel industry, can kneecap bodies like the American Petroleum Institute, which currently have a huge outside sway actually compared even to their sort of economic importance, and allow kind of more climate policy to come forward in the years to come. Because as we know, you know, this, none of this can really happen in a vacuum. The flip side of declining, making sure there's a managed decline in production, is that we need massive investment in green technology that can provide a scalable alternative to renewable energy. So, you know, this is one part of a Green New Deal that builds a, you know, thriving low carbon society as we transition away from our higher carbon one. So I think, you know, there's also, I'll end on this, just some interesting possibilities about what this could mean internationally. So, you know, right now there's a sort of shaky state of oil internationally, where, you know, the OPEC arrangement, which was sort of in power from the mid 70s until very recently, is not, you know, working in the same way that it has historically. And so what would it look like for kind of an American energy company which has nationalized fossil fuel assets to kind of engage with institutions like OPEC and in some ways return it to its, you know, original kind of founding mission of the more kind of radical left edge of OPEC, which really was thinking about things like resource conservation, thinking about, you know, how to justly distribute revenue from oil, and sort of reviving that conversation and really thinking through what this arrangement can look like in the 21st century in a way that, you know, is both thinking about the kind of global disparities and looking out for oil producers and countries which, you know, get a huge amount of their revenue from oil, and thinking about, you know, a global transition away from fossil fuels. This is, you know, I think this is not necessarily going to happen in the next year or so, but I think we have to think about oil in a kind of international perspective and think about energy and the Green New Deal sort of in a sense that, you know, really brings in the rest of the world into that vision. So yeah, I think I'll stop there. I just talked really quickly at you all about a lot of sort of complicated things. So excited to take questions.
Well, have no fear. There will be plenty of questions for you. That was Kate Aronoff, and my name is Dan Denver, and this is Jacobin Stay at Home, which is a video education project that we're doing most every single night at 6 p.m. during these stay-at-home months. And if you have a question for Kate, please, we're doing the Q&A now, so if you want to participate, just drop questions into the YouTube chat. And I'm going to start with one of my own before turning to a listener question, a viewer. I'm used to listeners. Viewer question that I see right over there. My first question is, like, what's the political landscape on nationalization? This would be one thing to be talking about if Bernie Sanders were president, let alone on a path to being president. But Donald Trump is president. Republicans control the Senate. And we live under neoliberal capitalism. So, like, what's the landscape in terms of, on the one hand, movements? Like, what's the discussion and strategy around nationalization amongst eco-socialists in particular, but also more generally the climate left? And then two, what's the political landscape amongst people in political and economic power, who are typically most often our enemies? And then how might changing conditions change that configuration of power and possibility?
Yeah, so there was an interesting moment, I think I mentioned earlier this week, where you had both like Donald Trump and the left considering some kind of serious intervention into the oil industry. So I think that's the baseline, is that there is going to be some, you know, much bigger intervention. I think there's debate about this, but I am not totally convinced that the Trump administration will move to nationalize production necessarily. I think there's like not the kind of policy entrepreneurship in the Trump administration that would be required for that to happen. I think maybe more likely would be stepping in some ways to rationalize production. So there was some talk about them, you know, pushing for some kind of supply controls, which, you know, may or may not happen. I'm not sure. I mean, the way kind of Trump has navigated this so far has been just to celebrate low gas prices. There's a great article, I think it was from Politico, where they kind of interview a bunch of industry insiders who are just like, so frustrated at the fact that Trump does not know how oil markets work, and is just, you know, continuing trying to get the price down. I think that's changed in the last week. I think it really remains to be seen. I mean, I think a bailout is probably in the cards, but my sense with that is that would be more so along the lines of a kind of blank check. Which again will not sort of fix the longer term problems that the industry is facing, namely the sort of drive to overproduction and this total, you know, chaos in shale that's gotten it into where it is. I mean, I think on the left, and I mentioned this at the beginning, but I think there is sort of excitement from groups like DSA and sort of increasingly from kind of left think tank world about nationalizing certain parts of production. I don't think that's yet trickled up into the kind of national conversation in the way we might hope. So for instance, this is not, you know, a thing that the Congressional Progressive Caucus or the Squad is kind of pushing for as part of its set of demands for a future stimulus package. And I think, you know, that's in part because oil is not something the left is really so adept at talking about. And so it's not, you know, made the jump from kind of circles of leftists talking about it to progressives talking about it in the way that, you know, something like a federal job guarantee or the Green New Deal has. So I think, you know, this may not necessarily be the moment, but I think, you know, your question brought up a very real possibility, which is a sort of right-wing nationalization, which would be more in line with kind of the national oil companies that we know already, you know, a Saudi Aramco, a Pemex, whatever, in their, you know, current form, current management. Which is not ideal, obviously. These are not, you could imagine, in theory, a sort of nationalization which looks to extend the life of the oil industry indefinitely and just sort of keep it going. And certainly if the Trump administration nationalized ExxonMobil tomorrow, it would not be with the goal of a managed decline in oil production to meet the, you know, the climate goals we should be striving toward. And so the way I like to think about nationalization is not, it's not really as some panacea or some cure-all, but a tool, right? And so I think even even a kind of right-wing government moving to nationalize production or even step into the oil market in serious ways and control production opens up an interesting possibility for, you know, a future Democratic administration for kind of left-wing policymakers.
In terms of the state of play of things on the left, speaking about the left more specifically as the socialist left, but also more broadly the kind of progressive left that brings in the left end of liberalism and then us to the left of that, to what degree is this an opportunity for coalition work between environmentalists and labor? You've talked a lot about the need to protect shale workers in this process. Have you seen things in terms of the development, for example, of the Green New Deal and the coalition work being done around that might come into play? In this case, I know hearing you and the other co-authors of A Planet to Win talk that that you don't necessarily consider frontline fossil fuel workers to be the lowest hanging fruit in terms of labor coalition partners.
That's accurate. Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, I think this is an interesting opportunity. I think if we do see something along the lines of what I was talking about, it will be as part of a recovery package, as most policy will be, but particularly for shale communities. And I think there's actually a sort of like political pragmatism to that, right? In that we're, you know, the country as a whole is probably going to be in a recession within the next quarter, an official recession, and likely a million fossil fuel workers will lose their job as a result of this price crash, which could mean a depression both in the industry, but also for sort of, you know, communities that are adjacent to it. So think about places like Appalachia, West Texas. There are, you know, communities whose livelihoods are built, you know, more deeply around oil than others. And so you could imagine a sort of part of a bailout or part of a recovery package, which looks specifically at communities which are bound up in fossil fuels in a more serious way. So I think it's a sort of tricky balance again between what are the kind of universal programs that protect workers generally, that, you know, should be strengthened and improved, what is sort of specifically targeted, to use a fraught word, to oil and gas adjacent communities. And I think that, you know, is not a problem that's necessarily been worked out. But I think, you know, if I were advising Nancy Pelosi or whoever, God forbid, after, you know, telling her to not put both of her fridges in the
maybe donate a fridge.
Yeah. Just don't show it off, you know, just hide your ice cream. So after that, probably say, you know, Texas is like a winnable state, right? Texas is a swing state, could go blue. Why not, you know, sort of talk about the depression which could happen in the shale fields and really look out for workers there. And, you know, have a, you know, way of talking about that, which is not, which, you know, is better than and more humane than the Trump administration.
To what extent are shale workers organized into unions? You think of a miner, conventionally, iconically, you think of a UMWA member, but when it comes to shale workers, I know they're paid really well, but my sense is that they're not organized into unions necessarily, and now they're out of work. Do you know anyone, do you know of any organizing underway to try to take it, for lack of a better term, take advantage of this moment of crisis in the industry?
I don't, but then again, it doesn't mean it's not happening. You know, it is more like gig work than something like a refinery, which are, you know, heavily unionized and have been for years and years. But I think, you know, that I would say that the more kind of unionized parts of the fossil fuel sector would be the places where that could potentially grow out of. So, you know, rank and file activism, unions like the steelworkers or the IBEW, I would imagine that would be, you know, a way that demand could kind of get into the shale fields in a way.
And just to follow up on an earlier question about just the role that coalitions have been playing in the development of the Green New Deal and anything we might learn from that.
Yeah, actually, I mean, I think I wrote a story a little bit a few months ago about Texas and the AFL CIO in the state endorsed two candidates running on a Green New Deal, one of whom will go to the general election, Mike Siegel, one of whom unfortunately lost, Jessica Cisneros. Yes. But I think it's a more, I think Texas is not the kind of, you know, right-wing bastion that it's made out to be. Sometimes there's a big, you know, history of labor activism there, and, you know, really kind of great organizing happening around the Green New Deal. The Texas AFL also, in part through organizing by DSA members, who are rank and file union members, passed this sort of a Green New Deal and everything but name for, you know, a just transition. So I think that's, you know, it's an interesting place to be doing work.
I've been incorporating viewer questions into some of the past questions, but more specifically, one that just popped up is, what could the lever of pushing to end ongoing fossil fuel subsidies do in this moment of massive market volatility? That's like obviously a long-term environmental demand. Do you see this fitting into nationalization?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is how certainly I've been thinking about nationalization. So it's really retooling the type of support that the state offers. So again, there's about $26 billion, conservatively speaking, in state and federal subsidies for fossil fuel production. And so the problem with oil right now is that there's too much production, right? And so we should not be subsidizing this thing that is, you know, for climate reasons, but also just for the basic economic rationality of the industry, bad. You know, the problem with oil has never been that there's too little of it. Generally, it's that there's too much and we need to curtail production. And so, you know, these subsidies, it's kind of a thicket of things.
For many years was obsessed with peak oil being the thing that was going to happen when it's precisely the opposite.
Yes, exactly. So yeah, I mean that we shouldn't be subsidizing massive amounts of production. Yeah. Because that's what's gotten us to where we are.
What is, just stepping back, like listening to you earlier, one thing that I was thinking is just like, why is it in particular that the oil industry runs into these coordination problems more than maybe any other industry, other sector under capitalism? And then like, what does that say about capitalism and about all sorts of free market ideologies if arguably the most fundamental industry in capitalism cannot survive without massive state intervention?
And you know, really has never been able
leading
to.
Question.
I think, I mean, you know, Timothy Mitchell writes about this in Carbon Democracy, and plenty of other people have too. But the part of the reason that oil took off is because it's able to be transported much more easily than coal, which it basically replaced in the energy system. So you have things like cross-border pipelines, tankers, which can send it abroad. And kind of the sites of production are interesting. So, you know, much of the oil for the 20th century was coming from the Middle East. It's a lot, you know, in places like Mexico and Venezuela. And so there's ways in which it maps on these like geopolitical conflicts, and that, you know, because we don't have like a functional international order generally, we also don't have a functional oil system or energy system that can, you know, figure out how to coordinate and deliver fuel to people in a way that makes sense. And so it's always, you know, been reliant upon having some kind of cartel to sort of, you know, coordinate production in a serious way, whether that's OPEC or like the Seven Sisters, people like Standard Oil sort of directing that. But yeah, I think it's a really damning indictment of anyone who tells you free markets exist.
It also seems like a pretty damning indictment, and maybe some of the rhetorical and political work would have to be done here of this whole kind of ethos of rugged American individualism, which for a very long time through the sagebrush rebellions of the 70s, through the present and the Bundys out in Nevada and then in Oregon, is all about this idea of a man's, and I use that, I use man intentionally, man's right to extract what he wants from his piece of land, when in fact, like that's a myth. This is a massively government intervened and government subsidized operation is there. I mean, Trump has proven pretty dramatically that just like that hypocrisy in and of itself is not an automatic problem for any given politician. But is there some way to exploit this extremely obvious hypocrisy?
Yeah, I mean, I think you were kind of alluding to this, but the goal of energy policy in the United States since the 1970s, since OPEC, you know, kind of came into prominence, was this thing called energy independence, which effectively just never existed, right? The price of oil and the U.S. oil sector has always been dependent on like a group of technocrats meeting in Vienna, who, you know, are not necessarily accountable to the U.S. government. And so there's been all sorts of ways that presidents have tried and administrations have tried to kind of navigate around that. And so far we see the Trump administration really failing to do that and talking about energy dominance. So we just have to, you know, export as much oil as we can to the rest of the world. But I think, you know, the idea of energy independence is a powerful one for a reason that aren't just entirely cynical. Yeah. And I do think there's a way in which, you know, if you are actually interested in this notion of energy independence, you should not be looking to run an economy based on oil, right? Solar, wind, renewables are much more amenable to, you know, cutting yourself off for the rest of the world. Not that that's what should happen. But if, you know, if you take energy independence literally, you would want to run an economy around renewables. And there are different ways to do that. I think there are a number of sort of like clean energy futures available. But certainly I think energy independence is an interesting frame that, you know, I think can't even in any way sort of be used to describe fossil fuel energy.
Yeah. There's definitely an opportunity, but it has to somehow be pried away from this sort of like Lockean settler colonialist notion that it's the guy out there just like, you know, mixing his labor with nature and then making like the oil flow, which is when I think what people are imagining when they in
like there will be blood.
Yeah, on the macro level, when they want the United States to be energy independent, independent, they're thinking on the macro scale of that kind of vision. Another question from viewers is oh, where'd it go? Would it be a bad thing if oil went away, but Exxon went green? Can Exxon be reformed or must it be abolished? And I guess the same question would hold for other sorts of companies as well.
Yeah, I think different people have different opinions on this. I am skeptical that Exxon or any of the other super majors could successfully convert to being clean energy companies just based on the way they're run. We see this already, like they're not on the verge of that. The top 20 oil producers on Earth, none of them in the last 10 years has spent more than 4% of their annual capital expenditures on alternative fuels, and usually much less than that. Usually it's like 1 or 2% max, which is these sort of like vanity projects that they go, you know, to like UN climate talks and sort of advertise. Exxon likes to talk about algae, for instance, or like, you know, it's like they probably spend less on that than they do on the advertising around it. So I think they probably won't. You know, I don't think, for as much as they talk about it, Exxon, BP, Shell, I don't think they probably will try to be energy companies. I mean, the interesting like counterexample, I guess, would be a company like Equinor, which was formerly Statoil, the Norwegian state-run oil company, which has been investing a lot in wind and making, I think, probably the most serious transition of any major oil company on Earth.
But they're a state-owned company.
They are a state-owned company, in fact. Yeah, and even they are not, you know, I think, are greenwashing in their own way.
Before we end, we should go to the where do we go from here question, which is, I know you and Thea and others have been working on this proposal for a green stimulus before oil prices totally crashed, though they were already crashing quite a bit, but they'd yet to go negative. What is the proposal for the green stimulus, and how does it fit in to this interlocking set of crises that we're now facing and in the middle of?
Yeah, so I actually was not involved in drafting the green stimulus, but Thea and Daniel Anna Cohen, two beloved co-authors,
only do stuff together.
We're a mass, you know. We only.
You wear too much of a journalist hat to do that, probably.
Yeah. Exactly. Anyway, but yeah. So, so there's an idea for this green stimulus, which, you know, as we wrote about in the book, is coming out of the response, the very, you know, disappointing response to the last recession, in which the Obama administration basically wasted its opportunity to do the biggest, you know, green stimulus package in history and transition the country away from fossil fuels. And so what the green stimulus proposal does, and people should check that out, it's on Medium. I think if you Google like green stimulus Medium, you'll find it, is to treat, you know, the economic recovery is a chance to, you know, transition into the kind of society we need. And so massive investments in renewable technology, massive investments, you know, to things like electric buses, but also put millions and millions of people to work. So seeing the having the government hire people directly instead of waiting for the private market to do that. And, you know, really sort of using this as a chance to build the low carbon society we need that's more functional on the other side and more resilient overall against both the climate crisis and future pandemics, which we know that climate change has a role in fueling.
All right. Well, I think at that we will finish up. We please subscribe to this YouTube channel, and then you will get all of the future YouTubes. I assume that's how YouTube subscriptions work. I should look into it first. That's my working understanding. And please share the videos and peruse our archives. That was Kate Aronoff, who is a staff writer at the New Republic and co-author of A Planet to Win, Why We Need a Green New Deal, which is a really excellent, extremely readable, rather short book, co-authored with Alyssa Battistoni, Daniel O'Donohue, and Fiorio Francos. Kate is also the co-editor of We Own the Future and the author of Overheated, How Capitalism Broke the Planet and How We Fix It, which is forthcoming from Bold Type Books. And she's also, last but not least, the co-author of the Hot and Bothered podcast at Dissent with Daniel O'Donohue. Please join us tomorrow night. There'll be at 6 p.m. there'll be a conversation with Daniel Finn, who will give us a brief history of Irish republicanism and then some context, some more recent context for Sinn Féin's electoral victory. And I'm Daniel Denver. I'm the host of The Dig, one of Jacobin's podcasts, and you should listen to it if you don't already. I'm also the author of a book on the history of anti-immigrant politics and how it kind of explains everything, with the title All American Nativism and the grandiose subtitle How the War, the Bipartisan War on Immigrants Explains Politics as We Know It. At that, I will leave it at that. Kate Aronoff, thank you very much. I hope to see you in person sometime again in the future.
Likewise. Thanks, Dan. Thanks, Jacobin.
All right. Bye, everybody. Thanks for joining us. We'll be right back.